I want to talk about physical activity and its impact with cancer, because it's one of the things that can help anybody that has cancer, regardless of what type of cancer they have. And it also can help prevent cancer. Less than 25% of cancer patients are active, and patients can feel overwhelmed with the guidelines, I feel like. And sometimes cancer treatment related fatigue is the problem, fear of injury, fear of lymphedema, fear of fractures. You know, in patients that have had bone metastases, I can understand why patients would be fearful of doing exercise. And maybe if you have bone metastases, it wouldn't be a good idea to do something that could be high impact where you could really hit your body. But probably walking is safe, and especially if you walk with someone else. Lack of education of the benefits, and I'm hoping I'm going to change that today with my talk, and lack of knowledge of how to get started. So these are the guidelines, and what I tell my patients is these are goals to work towards. It's okay to start small and have these guidelines as a goal. And if you never reach the goal of these guidelines, it's okay. If you go from doing nothing to doing some exercise, even if it's never these goals, it's okay. And that still helps you. It still helps you lower your risk of dying. It lowers your risk of getting cardiovascular disease. It lowers your risk of having side effects from your cancer if you do anything at all. And this is my talk seeing test that I mentioned earlier, but you want to kind of see what intensity am I working at when I'm doing exercise. So light is that you could sing a song while engaging in the activity. So like singing in the shower is light activity. Moderate is you could talk, but you can't sing a song. So these ladies here to the right, they're probably doing moderate activity. They're talking to each other. And then intense activity is you can't carry on a normal conversation. So I don't know about you guys, but when I'm swimming, I can't carry on a conversation. So that would be because I'm breathing really hard. Or if you're running, maybe you're breathing really hard. Or maybe for some people, even if you're walking fast, that you're breathing really hard, and that might be really intense for you. So there's this thing called the FITT principle, which is frequency, intensity, time, and type. So frequency is how many days a week are you exercising? The intensity, you measure it by the sing talk test. Time, the hours you're going per week, and your goal is to get to 150. But if you're not doing any exercise, if you did 5 minutes a day and you got, 35 minutes per week, that's still a lot more exercise than if you're not doing anything. That's still good. Type of exercise, whether it's aerobic or muscle strengthening activity. And I would argue that it's important to do the muscle strengthening activity. And if you get stronger by doing muscle strengthening activity, you can actually have more muscle capacity to do aerobic exercise. It makes it easier to do aerobic exercise if your muscles are stronger. So these are some tips for getting started. I went through these five things: log, move, lift, eat, sleep. And logging is, I think this is actually really important to get a notebook and write down what you did and any symptoms you had. So like if you went on a 10-minute walk and you felt better, to note that. If you went on a 30-minute walk and you felt totally wiped out, maybe that's too much. And it helps you kind of understand that when you do certain things, how are your symptoms? Are they better? Are they worse? And also to keep track of your protein intake and your sleep. Moving is the second part. And this is what's good to log what you did. Did you walk? Did you bike? Did you dance? Did you swim? Did you just do some exercise snacks and take a 5-minute walk? Any amount of exercise, even 5 minutes, is still beneficial. And if you can't walk, you can exercise in a chair. And there are programs for people to exercise in a chair. Lifting. And when I say lift, I really just mean strength training. It could be lifting weights, but it could also be doing yoga or body weight strength training, or even some of those exercises in the chair, which use your quad muscles and your forearm muscles and your back muscles and your core. Eating protein is important to support muscle growth, and proper hydration is important to support your cardiovascular system when you're exercising. And you should sleep as much as you need to feel rested. So for an average adult, that's 7 to 8 hours. But for some people, they don't need that much sleep. Most people need that much sleep and don't get it. But the other thing is that if you're getting cancer treatment, you also might need 9 hours of sleep or 10 hours of sleep. You might need more sleep to rest, and rest is an important part of physical fitness. So these are the five components of fitness for cancer patients: cardio, strength, balance, stretching, and rest. And you note that I put rest here. Rest is actually really important. And yoga, Tai Chi, and Qigong combine multiple components. This is some helpful equipment that you can use at home to exercise at home. A good old-fashioned yoga mat. There are these adjustable dumbbells that can go from 3 pounds up to, you know, 50 pounds to 60 pounds. These are good because you can start small, and as you get stronger, you can add more weight. And then there's also something that a lot of trainers like to use with cancer patients, which are resistance bands. So they're not weights. You can't drop them on your foot. There's no way you can really hurt yourself with them, but they're resistance bands to give you some resistance to strengthen your muscles. There's this type of exercise prescription called the Key 3. And these are three exercises that if you don't do anything else with strength training, or if you don't know where to get started, these are three moves that use about 80% of the muscles of your body. So one is just a bench press on the floor or on a bed. One is a squat with weights, which if you could do it without the wall, or if you need support, you could do it on the wall. And then the other one is called a dumbbell row, where you just pull the weight up, and this uses your back muscles. So this squat uses your posterior muscles, like your gluteal muscles, your rear end, your hamstrings, your quads. This uses your back, and this uses your chest muscles, your biceps, and your triceps. So it uses a lot of the main muscles of your body. So overcoming barriers, suggestions for helping you stick with it. Starting with exercise snacks, setting a workday walking routine if you can, finding a partner to exercise with you, because sometimes that really helps people stick with it. Exercising at home, using a DVD or an internet-based fitness program. Some people do like dancing online or Zumba. Some people just put on some music at their house and dance a little bit. That's fine too. Using tools to measure your steps. If you're a walker, if you're going to use walking as a big part of your fitness program, getting a pedometer and seeing how many steps you're taking, that can help you, because it can also help you see your progress as you get stronger. You can work with a fitness professional, and join a gym, but that's not necessary because there's a lot of exercise you can do at home, and you don't have to spend money to join a gym or get a personal trainer. The psychology of exercise, I mean, this is a big one. So questions to ask yourself and maybe explore with your healthcare provider are, what do you feel you're doing a good job with concerning exercise? So like maybe you're walking and maybe you're not doing any strength training, but you need to acknowledge the things that you are doing that are good. What activity would you most like to do if you started exercising? Are there barriers to starting exercising? And how could they be overcome? And then asking yourself, can I commit to taking some steps toward becoming more active? Even if it isn't those guidelines I talked about, even could you make a commitment to 5 minutes a day of something or some exercise snacks every day? And then, you know, strength training, there's options for everybody for strength training and building muscle mass. So you can do body weight exercises. If you're chair bound, you could do strength training in the chair or chair yoga. There's yoga, Pilates, Qigong, Tai Chi, and then there's weightlifting basics. And the key three that I have in the handout is an easy way to use 80% of your major muscle groups. That's an easy way to get started for patients if you don't know how to lift weights or you haven't done that before. And then these are my parting reflections before we stop and start the question and answer session. Never do nothing. Change the way you look at exercise. And I really feel like any exercise is better than none. And I just encourage you to try even a little bit and not to get discouraged if you can't do the full 30 minutes or the full amount. A little exercise goes a long way and it adds through the day. So if you can't take a 30-minute walk, but you could take 2 15-minute walks, that's still 30 minutes a day. That still counts. Exercise helps independent of weight loss or body mass index. So it's not what you look like. It's not whether you lose weight or not. Increasing muscle mass and fighting sarcopenia or low muscle mass, it increases the relative strength of your muscles for aerobic activity, and it's best accomplished through strength and resistance training. Exercise for cancer can help with prevention, recovery of function, and risk of recurrence reduction.